welcome, folks, and good morning to this nice, sunny, cooler weather. And we certainly have had a nice, warm week of it. And this morning, we will acknowledge again, as settlers, we respectfully acknowledge that Knox United Church, Durham, is on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabeg Nation, the people of the three fire confederacies known as the Ojibwe, Odawa, and the Potawatomi nations. We give thanks to the Chippewas of Saugeen, the Chippewas of Nawash, now known as the Saugeen Ojibwe Nation, as the traditional keepers of the land.
Let us gather for worship as we light the Christ candle. The light in all of life, shine bright light, shine upon me, filling me with your warmth and peace. Please join me for the call to worship. God, whose imagination saw all that is good, beautiful, and loving, continues to seize us as beloved children in the divine family. The word which called forth the stars in every universe speaks to us of giving ourselves through the baptismal life. The Spirit which moved over creation, breathing life into all things, fills us with peace and patience, with hope and healing to share. Let's pray together. Like creation on that first morning, may we tingle with anticipation of your goodness and wonder flowing into our lives, God who shapes all things. May we join all creation in worshiping you, who is as close as a heartbeat. As God whispered into the silence, you ran forth with creatures of every size and shape at your side, word of wonder. As river filled the valleys and ran for seas, as flowers sprang forth in meadows, as grace unfathomable sprang forth, may we join all creation in emulating you, who is as close as our flesh which you wore. As God's mind overflowed with dreams, you brooded over the waters, stirred the clouds with your wind, breathed life into all that is spirit of fanciful faith, planting the seeds of peace. May we join in all creation in dancing with you, who is as close to us as every breath we take. May we join all creation in worshiping, emulating, dancing as we offer our prayer to you, God in community, holy in one, as we worship you now. Amen. The hymn is God Who Gives to Life Its Goodness.
Thank you.
We know too well our foolishness, our brokenness, our human ways of doing things. But God knows our hearts, our hopes, our desire to be made new. As we offer our prayers of confession, let us open ourselves to God, who will forgive us and give us new life. Let's pray together. We have been created for goodness by you, artist of all things, but we continue to be filled with bitterness. Your word would enable us to speak joy to others, but we offer only judgment. The Spirit which breathes hope into us could be shared with everyone we meet, but we are tempted to hold our breath until we turn blue, rather than giving peace to those around us. But you have said that everything created is good, even when we foolish children of yours, God of wonder and grace, with the Spirit as our sister, we know we can bring healing and hope to those who need it most. With your word, Jesus Christ, as our brother, we know we can tell others of your mercy and of our love for them in every moment. By God's grace, our chaotic choices become creative grace for others. Our foolishness can be transformed by God's goodness. Our lives can become new by the Spirit of our God. The good news is as true as it was on creation's first morning. Creator God is the redeeming word, who is the breath of life for all people, even us. Thanks be to God for forgiveness and grace in our lives. Amen.
Nourish the life of the world in all.
Come on down. You don't want to do, okay, all right, you stay right there. You stay right there, that's okay. I have a question for all of you. Does anyone know what a pollinator garden is? Nobody, yeah, you know what a pollinator garden is? Okay, good. Did you plant one this year? You did, you have one. What did you put in your pollinator garden? Perennials? Anything that attracts bees or butterflies? And milkweed? Good. Now, if I just sounded like I was talking a foreign language to you, I wasn't. If you're not up to speed on what a pollinator garden is, it's a garden that attracts bees and insects and pollinators, things that pollinate our creation. One of the interesting things, the schools are very much picking up these pollinator gardens. And my wife did an interview with some students from Keppel Sarawak School. And I know that there's a group over in Meaford in the school there that are also doing pollinator gardens. And the idea is to provide a safe place for insects to feed and to pollinate and to get out there and do the things that they're supposed to be doing, which is what we want, instead of having them, well, become less and less and less. Pollination matters. It's part, an important part of God's creation. I noticed, for example, that at the Tom Thompson Gallery in Owen Sound, they're just rebuilding the whole front of the building to make it more accessible. And yes, part of that rebuilding of the front will include a pollinator garden. Now, it is getting a little on in the season to put in a pollinator garden, but I noticed my wife was doing some of it yesterday, so there still may be time. So if you're interested, ask around. Look it up on the internet. Check it out, because pollinator gardens are one of the ways that we can help. It doesn't matter how old or how young we are. It doesn't matter. We can all help in healing God's creation. And off you can go to Sunday school.
Our scripture reading today is from Genesis chapter 1, beginning at verse 1. 6 days of creation and the Sabbath. When God began to create the heavens and the earth was complete chaos, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome. And it was so. God called the dome sky. And there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees of every kind on earth that bear fruit with the seed in it." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed of every kind, and trees of every kind bearing fruit with the seed in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth." And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the dome of the sky. So God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves of every kind, with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters in the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things, and wild animals of the earth of every kind. And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every kind, and everything that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make humans in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So God created humans in his image. In the image of God, God created them. Male and female, God created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. God said, see, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw everything that God had made, and indeed it was very good. And there was evening and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. On the sixth day, God had finished the work that God had done, and God rested on the seventh day from all the work that God had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that God had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God. Let us keep silence for a moment. O Lord, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of all our hearts, be acceptable in your sight. Amen. It's not very often that I preach on the passage that Barb just read, the first creation story in the book of Genesis. Yes, it's long. It's probably one of the longest passages in the whole of the three-year lectionary cycle. But why does it matter? Well, it matters for a lot of reasons, but I'm going to focus on perhaps three. The first reason actually has to do with the context of the book of Genesis. You have probably heard literal interpretations of that book and that particular passage. The thing that happens when you start looking at Scripture literally is that you don't realize that in the book of Genesis, for example, there were four editors. Four. And they don't agree with each other. Because immediately following the passage that was just read, there's another creation story. Oh my goodness, what are we going to do? We could try and synthesize them. But that doesn't work either, because you lose a lot of important context between the stories. And this is a problem that is actually quite common to Scripture. Did you know that, for example, that there are two separate versions of the Ten Commandments? Oh, yes. Now, do you synthesize them, bring them together, or do you try and say, okay, what was each author trying to say? And acknowledge the fact that there are multiple authors here saying different things, and, well, what we have to do is let Scripture speak to us. And for me, that begins with trying to understand the, the reason behind the scripture. Why were there two creation stories? And what I've come up with is certainly not original, but I have an idea that the stories, in their plural nature, predate the writing down of the story and actually go back to the oral tradition of a nomadic people who were wandering from waterhole to waterhole with their herds, their flock, their cattle, their oxen, their community. And they were wandering in the land of the Middle East. And as they wandered around, they would spend the night or nights or months or weeks or months in a place, drinking the water, pasturing their cattle or their sheep. And they were a larger community, multiple generations all living together. And I can imagine a young person sitting around the fire at night, kind of sheltering against the cold, and looking up at the sky and asking the question, where did this come from? What are all those points of light up there? And I can see one of the elders of the community stroking their beard and saying, well, in the beginning, God. And what we have is a story that helps to explain what was. It helps to explain creation. That does not deny or negatively impact on what we understand of creation today. My golly, if we look at the James Webb telescope peering back into the very dawn of creation, we understand creation in a very different way. But for the people of the book of Genesis, in the beginning, God. The other thing, I think, is that there are some common truths in both passages. But in the first one, the passage that says, let us make humans in our image according to their likeness, certainly jumps out at me. Many years ago, in my early chaplaincy training, I went to visit someone. And I introduced myself as the hospital chaplain. And I was told, get out! Get out! I was not welcome. So I left. The visit troubled me, and I raised it in our reflection group and talked about it with my supervisor. And we came to the decision that I would go back and at least stick my head in the door and say hello and perhaps offer a greeting. So I did that. And the person in the bed, who was still there, this is back in the days, you know, pre-in and out of the hospital overnight, this person said to me, I'm sorry. I was rude. And I was wrong. And I replied, you were. Are you up for a visit? And I was actually graciously received. The lesson for me in that encounter was that all of us are created in God's image, and that we are all saints and sinners in one body. And the real point is that God doesn't care. God loves us no matter what. God loves us because we are created in God's image. We belong to God and are a whole person in God, a whole person complete with a package of small evils, sometimes big evils, alongside our better angels, as one commentator put it. This was made real this week at Trinity United Church in Beamsville, where a group of youths cut down the Canadian flag and the Pride flag in front of the church and then shredded the Pride flag. And they left both flags on the ground. The security video, the security footage, was unfortunately too grainy to identify the specific individuals. But Niagara Regional Police are investigating the vandalism as a potentially hate-based crime, which takes it up more than just a this is just simple vandalism. It takes it up a few notches. Trinity United Church in Beamsville was recently designated as an affirming church within the United Church of Canada, which means they accept and welcome everyone, no matter what their race, gender, sexual orientation, or identity is, housing rigor or status of housing, poverty, or marginalization. There's a whole process you go through in the United Church to becoming an affirming congregation. And there are congregations in this region who are, one of which I know is Georgian Shores United Church in Owen Sound. To get back to Trinity Beamsville, the flagpole was repaired and the flags were raised again. And according to the board chair of the congregation, if police do find out who is responsible for destroying the flag, they hope the church can respond to the act through education and conversation. We don't want to yell at them. We don't want them to tell them they're terrible people. We just want to understand what they were thinking when they did it and see if there's anything that we can do differently to help them think differently, according to the board chair. And that is exactly what it means to see people in the image of God. Instead of punishment, and they'll leave the legal system to do its thing, trust me, the church is seeking restoration of relationship. And that is the difference. That's what it means to be made in the image of God. The second passage I want to comment on in that very long reading was God saw everything that God had made, and indeed, it was very good. The innate goodness of creation is something we often forget in our drive to fulfill our wants, needs, and desires. But if we're made in God's image, the other side of that coin is that we are placed in God's creation, and we have a responsibility living in that creation. Our statement of faith, which we used last Sunday, calls us to live with respect in creation. And if we follow that train of thought, creation is indeed a gift of God. And caring for creation is what we are called to do, and is indeed a spiritual commitment. We cherish creation's rich diversity and respect its inherent value and its right to protection. We have all too often interpreted the passage that we read this morning as having dominion over, as having the right to exploit creation and to take from whatever we want from creation without acknowledging we have a responsibility to creation. Unless we think that we are without responsibility, I point out that climate change is as close as the air we breathe. If you were not aware, we are subject today to smoke from wildfires in Quebec and Northern Ontario. And we have been subject to smoke from wildfires in Alberta already this year. And we have seen the destruction that has happened in Alberta and in Nova Scotia. And it is the kind of thing that boggles the mind, but reminds us of our responsibility. The impact is not just on us. These local systems of which we are a part. But our partners around the world, our global partners as a church, are also deeply affected by all of this. The greatest burden of climate change is falling on people in the far north and global south who have contributed the least to the problems of climate change and climate value. Indigenous voices in the church remind us that we are called to look after the Creator's gifts and to pass along these gifts to our children. And we can be part of a just transition to a renewable economy by pressuring our governments and industries to do more and to end our unsustainable consumption through our lifestyle choices and work towards what is called climate justice. This congregation is taking a step in a very real and tangible way. And if you didn't think about that, you might wish to. And although we are forced to replace our heating system because it was held together with duct tape and baling wire, the benefits of what you saw this morning up on the screen will reduce our carbon footprint significantly. And stay tuned, because in about a year, we will have concrete results. That's part of the Faithful Footprints grant. It's not just the church giving us money. Our responsibility is to show how much we have changed, and there will be tangible results. So far in the program, where the United Church has said we are going to reduce our carbon footprint by 80% by 2050, we've already reached the level of 20%. That's pretty darn good, but there's a lot more work to be done. But we have joined with 150 other congregations across this country. When we chose to replace our current heating system with something that is much more energy efficient, and which will, in fact, benefit all of us. Someone has said, and I'm sure our treasurer, Lisa, will be watching closely the bills, there will be more money available for ministry by the reduction in our natural gas bill. If we believe that creation is good, then this is a way we can care for creation, reallocate our expenses, and focus on our goals and our calls as our call as a congregation. When we consider creation as a whole, we are part of that creation. And it is indeed an article of our faith to care for that creation. May we do so, although it is not easy. The path is crystal clear. Let us pray. Thank you, O God, for all that you have given us, including this creation in which you have placed in our hands. May we care for this creation in all that we do as we move forward into the future. Amen. The hymn is, "We Meet You, O Christ."
Human decree, you choose to be.
let us present our tithes and our offerings for the work of the Lord. Like the gifts of creation, we are but stewards of all we possess. And like the gifts of creation, they are not to be hoarded, but shared with the hungry, the lonely, the lost, the struggling. As we offer our gifts, to receive our thanks and praise in the name of Jesus. Amen. As God's people, let us pray. Loving Creator God, we give thanks for all your work. The heavens, the oceans, the dusty deserts, the luscious jungles. You have entrusted us to care for, to nurture, and to support all the wonders of the world. We ask for your guidance as we seek to do better, to be your healing hands and show your love for us and the world in our actions to protect the environment. Throughout history, we have been too quick to tear down or attempt to remodel your creation, rather than consider how you placed each and everything on this earth for a reason. Every creature is unique. It has a purpose and a place. Amazing God, you placed every single twinkling star in the sky, and you know them each by name. You are all-powerful, untamable, and mighty. You are love, gentleness, and compassion. Awestruck, we fall on our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Empower us to make ethical choices in community with one another as we use our actions to worship the earth's beauty. Because if we try to do this alone, we will fall short. May our actions be mindful of the different privileges, abilities, and resources that we have, always striving to lift up those most affected by the climate crisis, but who have contributed the least to it. As we seek to deliver your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven, may we turn our attention to you, Lord, and never cease to give thanks for your works. This we pray in the name of Jesus, who showed us his way in these words: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The hymn is Praise with Joy the World's Creator. Called to be faithful stewards, we are sent forth by our God. We will take all that is good to places of brokenness, all that is beautiful to those who live in despair. Called and commissioned to be faithful disciples, we are sent forth by Jesus, word of hope. We will follow Jesus to every place he would lead us, to every person who will bless us. Called and filled with the very breath of peace, we are sent forth by the Spirit, God's grace.
We will join the Spirit in bringing life where there is fear, in offering love where hate seeks to take hold.
And now may the peace of creation's imagination, the peace of grace's word, the peace of hope's spirit, and the deep, deep peace of God in community, holy in one, be with you this day and for always. Amen.